same way. So first goal, I will start from ground zero. I will define what a Lie algebra is. I will define what a representation is, and essentially nothing will be assumed beyond linear algebra. But since we started in this way, our first order is to classify what are semi-simple Lie algebras over complex numbers, and then we will study what their representations are. That everything is completely reducible, how the irreducible ones are classified, mainly by their highest bit, and what their dimensions are, a little more refined information by this character formula. So this is going to occupy us for some time. Then we will go in a different direction. But since we are following the text of Humphreys, we will also see something about how to define groups over integers by having a certain way. How to work over integers. I cannot be more precise right now. So we will see some of this. But the second half will be devoted to studying not just infinite dimensional representations of finite dimensional Lie algebras will be important for us to finish probably.
Okay, so where were we? Yeah, right. So we'll study representations as finite dimensional semi-simple Lie algebras, their representations, Weyl character formula, and then we will go on to study infinite dimensional generalizations of this stuff. By that I mean certain infinite dimensional Lie algebras and character formulas for them. So let's start out by defining the Lie algebra, and which I will do, and then I will say something about this. So what's a Lie algebra? And usually we use this, but since we are following the text of Humphreys, I will say L. But the terminology may be schizophrenic. You know, some people may use that script G, and I myself may switch between the two. Okay. So what's a Lie algebra? L. So first of all, it's a vector space, and immediately questions arise over which field. And so our I'll write down nearly always. In fact, I can really say always, but some things nearly always the field which Humphreys denotes by F will be just another name for complex numbers. In particular, we will want the field to be algebraically closed and of characteristic 0. The characteristic 0, we can do business without that, as Professor Seshadri mentioned, but algebraic closure is really important at a basic level, and then if you want to do without that, then the theory becomes more sophisticated. But for us, we'll do this. A vector space over a field F, and in the beginning part it will always be finite dimensional. Bilinear product L cross L to L, or a linear map, right? So this is an unnecessary comment at this stage, but just to remind that multilinear algebra will also be important for us. So we have a bilinear product. In each slot it is separately linear, which has other properties, and namely this product is skew symmetric and it is not associative. Instead, it follows the Jacobi identity. So you can tell me what the so we will call this. So this is x, y goes to what we call bracket of x and y, with the property that bracket of anything with itself is 0. This is really skew symmetry, right? Which is to say that bracket of x, y is minus of bracket of y, x. And how are these two related to each other? You just expand bracket of x plus y with itself and use bilinearity, right? So it is if and only if if the characteristic is not 2. If the characteristic is 2, then you actually prefer this. And the Jacobi identity. So, what is the Jacobi identity? So, I will write it the way it's done, but that's not how I think of it. So, what do you do? So, this is the same format, right? You have a bracket inside a bracket which is on the left, and then what do? You put x, y, z in cyclic permutation. So, what will be the next thing? Y, z, x, and then z, x, y. So, this is all right, but maybe better. There is a better way to think of this, which we will shortly see. So, that is the definition of the algebra. So, as soon as we have that, let us look at examples. And one can go in this algebraic spirit. You can say, okay, I will take a vector space, finite dimensional, just call the basis whatever x1 up to xn. And since the product is bilinear, so I will just write, just scribble this here, but I am going to erase it because it will be a very horrible viewpoint. So, a basis I going from 1 to n, because the product is bilinear, all you have to determine is how it works on the basis, and then it will be some sigma Cij, Cijk xk, right, sum will be over k. But these constraints have to be satisfied, so that will mean some constraints on the Cij case. This is a terrible thing. I mean, you can do this, and the book has some exercises, and we will want to solve all the exercises in the book, by the way. You can do this for, but this is not why we study Lie algebras. This is not why Lie algebras, how Lie algebras come about. So how do they come about? And the answer is, they come about this way, because there is a group. The way we are operating this course, it's really we are committing a sin, in that we are treating this as a purely algebraic subject, but it is not. So, a Lie algebra comes about as a linear, as an infinitesimal version of a group, a manifold which is also a group, so a Lie group, or later on you can study as algebraic groups. And then what is this bracket? So, this bracket is somehow related to the group structure, right? This is something that we are going to completely ignore in this course, but it is something which is worth studying. So, we will probably include some of this in the tutorials. So, how the, so just to say a few words, a Lie group is a manifold which is also a group, such that the group operations are smooth. And then the Lie algebra is the way you study smooth things. You try to linearize the problem. That's how we start math, studying maths, right? Basic maths, calculus, by studying tangents. So you look at the tangent space. The group has a multiplication structure which takes you from point to point, right? If you have some point y, if you multiply it by x, you go to xy. So, tangent spaces at different points are related. So, you look at a single tangent space, namely the one at the identity, because that is the easiest one to look at. And the fact that your manifold has a group structure will mean that the tangent space is not only a vector space, but it will have this Lie product. How does this come about? Well, we won't do it here, but hopefully there will be some problems on that. Okay, so the examples that come, natural examples that come that way from Lie groups, but we will still write down some of them. examples. So first some silly examples going from that point of view. For example, you see there is one particular stupid way of writing, of defining a product which will ensure that both of these are trivially satisfied. Namely, if I declare that all products are zero, right, then everything is zero. So that we call an abelian Lie algebra, and it will be the Lie algebra of an abelian Lie group where all products are zero. So abelian ones. But the primordial example is the example of which by definition, so the script GLV is really the set of all endomorphisms of a vector space V. So the vector space itself is the set of all operators, and then I have to define what the product is. So X, Y, so X and Y are matrices, remember. So by definition this is X, Y minus Y, X, the commutator. So you see that this is obvious, and this is something that you just have to check, and you do have to check it once in life. Sit down and do it, okay, to see that everything cancels out. So in what sense is this a primordial example? The same sense in which, how do groups come about? Groups come about as symmetries of things, right? Symmetries of a set if there is no other structure. So the primordial group is the permutation group. And then later on we become a little more ambitious, and if you want to study groups, we put them not inside permutation but inside invertible matrices, right? GLV. In the same, in a similar way, what is a primordial example of a module over, of a ring? The ring of endomorphisms of an abelian group. If you take an abelian group and you study all of, and you take all of its homomorphisms, under pointwise addition it becomes a group, and under composition it becomes a ring. So in what way are these primordial examples? Is that these are concrete ways to study abstract objects. That's how the objects were first motivated. So the first example that you study of a representation, so to speak, is a group acting on a set. There is no linear structure. That's how you put a group inside a group of permutations. Then when you study linear representations of a group, you put the group inside a homomorphic image, but you put a group inside matrices. When you study a module over a ring, what does that mean? That ring acts on an abelian group. There is a ring homomorphism from R into end of M. And similarly, we will have representations of a Lie algebra. And how will the representations be? That you will put a Lie algebra inside this Lie algebra. Okay? The object on which the Lie algebra will act is this vector space V. So the word representation, I will write down. Representation of Lie algebra L is a map from L. And what sort of map should it be? It should be a Lie algebra homomorphism, right? So we are naturally led to the notion of a homomorphism. So we have I'm not really following this, but so Lie algebra homomorphism. Lie algebra homomorphism phi. And what should a Lie algebra homomorphism mean? Well, it's obvious. It should first of all be a linear map. These are vector spaces, and it should preserve the bracket. Where the bracket here is the canonical bracket, the one that is defined here, the commutator. The algebra homomorphism phi, that is phi is linear and phi preserves okay. But let me back up, because I want to I want to discuss a few more examples before we go to vocabulary. All right, so this is the basic example, and the first theorem in group theory that you do is that every group is isomorphic to a group of isomorphic to a subgroup of the full permutation group. In other words, it's a permutation group. So natural thing to expect would be that every Lie algebra is that theorem is true in characteristic 0, but it's a difficult theorem, Ardo's theorem. Nonetheless, without assuming these theorem, what we can say is, what is a linear Lie algebra? A linear Lie algebra is something which is isomorphic to a subalgebra of GLV, which means that it has to be a vector subspace and it has to be closed under the bracket. It does not have to be closed under multiplication, but it has to be closed under bracket. So what are some examples? Linear Lie algebras are subalgebras of some. The reason why I write this as opposed to end of V is because I want to emphasize the structure of this as a Lie algebra. So can you give some examples of linear Lie algebras other than the full thing and 0, of course? Okay, so some examples. So we will, so this is called the general linear Lie algebra, this is the special linear Lie algebra. This is related to the group capital GLV, this is related to the group capital SLV. In what way, we will just see in a moment. I will define this also, but some simpler ones. So you see the group of the set of all diagonal matrices, B, let us not use V. I cannot get the font correct, okay, but D sub n. If I take all diagonal matrices, they are closed under bracket. In fact, the bracket is, if I take any two diagonal matrices, the bracket is 0. So this is an abelian Lie algebra. What if I take upper triangular matrices? So the book's notation is this P. If I take two upper triangular matrices, what about their bracket? Well, what about their product? Okay, so this is a small reminder about matrix multiplication. How do I write matrix multiplication without writing long brackets and several entries? Okay, so how is the way, what's the way to write that? 0 sometimes and 1 sometimes. Delta. So all the upper triangular matrices form a Lie algebra, a linear Lie algebra, and the strictly upper triangular ones also form a Lie algebra. So these will be important for us. Okay, so this subscript n and this script n, maybe I will just say k. These are k by k matrices. Now SLV, this is the space of all matrices of trace 0. Okay. And you see, this is interesting. If I multiply two matrices having the same having trace 0, will the trace of the product be 0? No need, right? But trace of xy and trace of yx are the same always. So this shows two things. One, for one thing, if I take this SLV, then it's a Lie algebra in itself. But moreover, if I take the bracket of any two matrices, it will lie in SLV. So this is trace zero matrices. And a little word here, you know. So we are talking about, going back to the group connection. We are talking about Lie algebra being the tangent space. So how is, I will write this over here, SLV is in fact normal GLV, which is defined by what condition? The determinant equal to 1, right? So you can think of it as a constraint. This is a polynomial function, right, on those n square coordinates, and this is defined by trace being 0. So determinant of matrix A being determinant being 1 and trace being 0. But I should not write A here, because the objects in the Lie algebra are supposed to be tangent vectors. So I should use a different, of course I can confuse the two, because I can identify the tangent space to this manifold being the space of all matrices themselves, but there is an identification going on there. Okay. So somehow this condition is supposed to be the derivative of that condition. Okay. It is not an arbitrary equation. Similarly, if you take other examples, so I will just say classical Lie algebras, and I will just write down their names A, L, B, L, C, L, D, L. This A, L is just the group S, L, the special linear Lie algebra of dimension L plus 1 by L plus 1. Okay. And what are B, C, and D? They come from groups which are groups of matrices which preserve a non-degenerate bilinear form. So the form in two cases, this is a symmetric bilinear form where the dimension of the underlying vector space is either even or odd respectively, and this is where the form is alternate. Now if you have an alternate that is q-symmetric non-degenerate bilinear form on a vector space, then what can you say about the vector space? Does every vector space have a
even?
It has to be of even dimension, right? So there is only one case there. Now why do we make a difference between odd and even case in case of symmetric bilinear form? That is because the associated combinatorics, and this will be a whole new a whole different parallel development going on, which we will I think begin today, root systems. So a few more words. So these examples are extremely important, not just because they are classical, but in some sense they are all the examples of the kinds of Lie algebras that we are interested in. So the classification that we are working towards, we'll say that every semi-simple algebra, Lie algebra, will be a direct sum of these examples and five exceptional ones. So this is a general thing about this subject, that the subject has a lot of general theory, but all the while we are talking about examples, and examples are far more representative than maybe in some other branches where there are lots and lots of examples. Here in some sense we know what objects we are talking about, and the theory is a very nice way to understand all of it conceptually. But it really is a subject of examples, and so that means that in the tutorials you will be working with these examples a lot. Okay, so back. Yet another way, I will just mention this, Lie algebras of derivations of an algebra. And this algebra A need not be associative. So first of all, what is an algebra? It really is, forget this word, it's a vector space over a field as equipped with a bilinear product. Often we take this to be an associative algebra, that is XYZ doesn't depend on which way you put the parentheses. But for this particular definition, I don't even need that. So I just have a vector space with a bilinear product defined on it. And what is a derivation of such a thing? Well, it's a derivative. What's a derivative?
the algebraic way of thinking of a derivative, if you have seen tangent vectors as point derivations. So it's a linear map which has to satisfy the Leibniz rule, right? So a derivation D from A to A, which is going to be F linear, remember F is our vector space, F linear, such that D of let's not use bracket, D of AB is, I will put a dot here just to show that there is some kind of product going on here. So what should that be? You are going to write exactly the familiar product rule in calculus. So this is going to be BA times B plus A. So we should be very careful about order and things like that here. Okay. So B times D of D of B times A is that's not the way we should go. We should keep the order. So it should be A times D of B. This dot is being the same one. Now it is a fact to check that if you take two derivations, there are two linear operators, right, from this vector space to itself. Even before being an algebra, it's a vector space. So if you take two derivations, if you take their product, by product I mean there is only one way to take a product, composition, that need not be a derivation. But if you take the bracket of those two, that will be a derivation. So what should be in the bracket of two derivations? Those are two linear operators, right? So I can do that. I can think of it as a bracket in end of capital A. So check that bracket of two derivations is a derivation. Check that bracket of D1, D2, just for, you know, this is going to be lying where? In end of A, again, is a derivation. And some of the exceptions, remember I said that all the semi-simple ones are built out of taking direct sums of these and five exceptional ones. Some of those exceptional ones arise in this fashion, or allied in, you know, arise in a manner related to this fashion. Sure, I think the octonions give something. No, Shripa? The F4 I think comes in some such, or even G2, I don't know what. It's constructed in this fashion. Okay, so we have a bunch of examples and you will work with them more in the tutorials. Let's talk about vocabulary. This is exactly the type of thing where you follow your nose, because you have seen this many times. Okay. You have an algebraic structure, you want to study its homomorphisms, which has a natural definition. The moment you have homomorphisms, you are led to consider its the kernel of a homomorphism. The kernel of a homomorphism will not just be a Lie subalgebra, but it will be, I mean, think of a ring. It has some kind of funky product here, but it is like a ring. So let's say kernel of, what is this by definition?